Well, it is Stewardship Month, and I hate Stewardship Month because everybody hates Stewardship Month. And then I thought about it. Why would I hate Stewardship Month? It is one of the great things in my life, greatest things in my whole life, K&I, has been giving, sharing our wealth and our time and so forth. It's the greatest thing. Why am I hiding this? And by the way, I want to just talk about it. We're talking about money now because we're on 2 Corinthians. We're making our way through the New Testament. We're at 2 Corinthians, and it just so happens that it's a book that I call Stewardship. Romans is salvation. 1 Corinthians is sanctification. And then you get to 2 Corinthians, and it's stewardship. So it worked out perfect. But I want to tell you just a little hint here. You do not have to give. You get to give. You get to give. Now, I was so blessed because, I mean, if you're giving 1% of your income, and by the way, a tithe is an Old Testament term, the church was even more generous than 10%. They shared everything in the early church. And then even we're going to get to the church in Macedonia, how they shared and gave everything. So, I mean, tithe isn't even close to what we're supposed to be doing. We're supposed to be moving more and more towards giving and sharing and impacting the world. That's where we want to move. You get to choose where you put that money. We are free, not under compulsion, as it says. You don't have to give a cent. You get to give. You know, I just thank God that I started off, because if you start off wanting to tithe, and by the way, I tithe from the beginning just because it just works out. It's a nice amount. And but again, we want to move past that. We want to make a difference in this world, a big difference in this world. We do, don't we? I mean, isn't that what we're all about? But giving is tough because we live in a culture that is a lot of pleasure. If you find pleasure, if you buy enough stuff and so forth, kind of hooked into that mindset. And we have been for decades, ever since the dishwasher came out and all those other things that make life so wonderful. It's almost like, remember those old commercials? It's almost like you'd be transformed. Your life would take on new meaning if you got a dishwasher. Your washing machine. No, that's even bigger, isn't it? You don't have to give. You get to give. But I was blessed because at age 13, I came to know Christ and I got excited about Christ. And by the way, you're not going to be excited about giving if you're not excited about Christ. You're not going to be excited about giving towards increasing the kingdom of God without it. So basically, my stewardship sermon would really be this. Get to know Christ better. And we wouldn't ever have to talk to you about evangelism, stewardship, anything. You understand what I'm talking about? Churches are full of people who just haven't caught Christ yet, haven't caught the excitement. And this probably isn't for you then. But what we want to do is we want to get all of us connected to Christ in such a way. That's why we do John 17. That's why we're trying to do Alpha. That's why we're trying to do all these things. Because it starts here. If you got excited about Jesus Christ, if you haven't been before, we won't have to tell you anything because you're going to do it. So at 13, the first day, the day after the night I gave my life to Christ, woke up and my teenage brother and 22-year-old brother taught me about stewardship. And they said, 10% is kind of a good amount. That was the Old Testament. So 10%, I started off right away, and I was 13. And so I calculated, got home, calculated. I don't have a job, so I'm not making anything. 10% of that. See, it's easy when you start with it, right? Before you get it, but when you fill your life up with having spent all your money, because we do fill it up. We buy the house equivalent to what we can pay for. We buy the car in the same way, right? And so I'm just so happy because if you give 1% of your income, you can't jump to 10% in 1 year. You can't because it's all committed. You're going to have to peel some things back and so forth. I thank God that age 13, I started to tithe. I became a waiter, and I'd come home with tips, and I would count up, $22. I'd take $2.20 and put it away, and then when I got a check, I'd do the same. And I haven't stopped. It is, outside of the loved ones that I have in my faith, it is the greatest thing in my life. Why wouldn't I want to talk about it? And by the way, again, you're not under compulsion. And Paul at one point says, I'm not commanding you. But again, it's a joy. It's a pleasure. Why does he talk about cheerful giving? Because you can be cheerful givers. But we want cheerful givers. And you are free to decide how you want to give your life, time, treasure, talent. You're free. We are free as Christians. And we believe if we do a good enough job here about impacting the world and growing faith, then I think you will want to give to this place. Churches need money. We want money. We want more money because we want to do more things. We want to impact the world more. We want to see more women and men come to faith in Jesus Christ. We want more. I want more. Don't you? I want more. And so it was easy for me to tithe because I started off at nothing. And so it was kind of built in for me. But it has been a pleasure of our life. And there's times when we had no money. And we start thinking, you know, should we stop tithing? And I think there probably was a time of a few months where we did. But even when we were hurting, even when we were taking, I'm almost down to food stamps, but we were taking certain things because we were new in ministry, didn't have a lot of money. And even then, we kept tithing, even when it hurt. Now, our experience has been, well, for instance, my first experience with stewardship was when I was in college and I was in Tulsa, Oklahoma. My family was back in Minnesota, and I had committed to paying for everything, all the expenses of toiletries, you know, fun, all that kind of stuff I was responsible for. So I worked in the summer, but by February, I realized it was going to run out. I'd be out of money. I could have begged my folks, and they could have, you know, given me a loan, but I didn't. And, you know, I realized I have it down to $100, and within a few weeks, I'd be out. So what does it matter whether I'll be out then or now? So I said, I'm just going to give it away. Because, well, why not? We're just weeks away from it just disappearing anyway. And so I prayed to God, you know, how would you want me to give this money? And then I thought about an old Pentecostal preacher that I and my brothers and sisters went to after our conversion. We saw him once in a while, Harry Hillman. He and his wife, they did a ministry in St. Cloud, Minnesota, which tried to bring churches together. And that kind of came into my mind. I thought, Lord, do you want me to give to Harry Hillman, his ministry? And I was just down at the bottom of my 20 or 12-story dorm building and ready to go out running, jogging. Back in those days, we had those big things weighed about 50 pounds over your ears, the radios, you know? Remember that? So, you know, you run like this. You had to go, you had to pull that hair back to get that. Oh, man, now we got little earbuds. Why didn't they do that before? Although it did burn more calories. That's the good news. And I started, and I said, God, if you want me to do this, then make it clear. Put the earphones on, headed out away from the dorm, and right away, the first song on the Christian radio station was a song called something about the fountain, Cleansed in the Fountain. Never heard it. I am 52, and think of all those days. All those days and all the Christian music I've listened to, I have never heard that song. Except Harry Hillman, the pastor, and his wife would sing it occasionally at his church. What I'm getting at here is all of us have a mission from God. We need to be open to seeking it. But by the way, if you're going to be open to seeking it, it's going to be sacrifice. We need a church that is sacrificial, ready to give, ready to mount an attack and bring Jesus Christ to the world, or to care for the lonely and the homeless and so forth. Yeah, that was kind of exciting for me that God would partner with me to give to a particular cause. I remember also once we didn't have much money at this point. It was decades ago, and we had an investment of $500 somewhere. I think it was in some investment with our investor. Yeah, he sure loved us. Yeah, can we? Well, that $5 on the. We went to pick up the $500, and we had five $100 bills, and we went to this monthly women's thing that I was kind of a pastoral overseer of, and they had speakers and so forth. And afterwards, they pointed out a woman and said their trailer house burned and everything in it. And then all of a sudden, my heart, I'm thinking. And Kay was thinking the same thing. You know, our situation isn't that bad. Why don't we take, you know, why don't we help a little bit? So we both knew at the same time that we're going to get it. And as far as I can tell, we made it. And nobody's still running after us for owing them anything, I don't think, Kay, have they? No. It's not a process of just, you give your money to the church. No. Play with this. You have money, you got time, you got talent. You figure out what you want to give. There's freedom in this. This is Christian freedom here. And you give to what you want to give to. I remember, I forgot his name now. He was in Dodge City. He was 100 years old, and he would give $3 to, like, everybody. So then you get more mail and more ministries. He'd have me over every other month, and he'd be a stack this big. I swear, it's this big, literally, of people wanting money. And he said, what should I give it to? I said, you give it to what your heart, what God is telling you to give it to. That is, what do you care for? Do you care? You care for the poor? You care for kids in high school that aren't making it? Or do you care for nursing home residents and trying to care? What is it you care about? And I said, don't answer any of those mails. Just throw them away. You figure out what you are called to give to and give it. But then 2 months later, he said, could you come over and go through the mail with me? We are free to give, and it is one of the most joyful things in our lives. Joyful things in our lives. And again, you get to give what you want to give. Now, the point is this, though. In the Christian church, we're going to encourage you to give more. Wherever, give more. We're not just trying to use you here. We are trying to empower you to be what you're supposed to be. And it's going to take some time, and that's the fun of it. Now, in Corinthians, they're dealing with famine in parts of the Mediterranean world. Christians in Jerusalem are dying. And Israel, what used to be Israel, Palestine later, people were starving to death. There was a full-blown famine. And all over the Mediterranean where there were churches, they were gathering their money. And he was talking to the 2 Corinthians church throughout the letter. He hints at this problem, you know. And he kind of uses a little blackmail too. Well, there's a church in Macedonia that's doing really good at giving. But that's what he's speaking to. He's talking to a church. He's talking about collecting, sending some leaders of the church to collect the money. And together, so there's accountability, there's more than one person carrying the money, bring it to the church in Jerusalem. That's what he's talking about. And that's the need that he's seeking to meet through his letter. Now, what the quotes. I put some bunch of quotes down because 2 Corinthians is a who's who, I said. A who's who of verses on stewardship. It's a who's who. It's like you go into the who's who museum when you go to 2 Corinthians. You open that door, you come in, oh, he talks. The great quotes are in here. You know, he gives sparingly, he'll reap sparingly, those who, you know, that type of thing. Well, just most all of them. But the first one is this, and this is a key verse of the whole book. Jesus Christ, though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich. Can you imagine that? God became poor in Christ because of his love for us? Do you realize he gave us everything, right? Think of how rich we are. Go read Ephesians chapter 1 to talk about your riches. Think about your riches sometime this week. The forgiveness of sins and redemption and adoption, and it goes right down the list. We are incredibly rich. We've been given more than $50 million. Way more than $50 million. How are we going to respond? How do you respond to that? How many of you are Monk watchers, the series Monk? The detective? Okay, Monk, okay. He's a detective, but he's got OCD. And he would have been in church today, but he was worried about germs. And he was a brilliant detective, maybe one of the best in the whole world. And then there's this, they introduce this character, Dorfman. Kevin Dorfman, who was, Kevin Dorfman was a character. He won the lottery. He won millions of dollars. But in the process, Monk and his assistant saved him. Saved his life from a murderer. So he comes over and he's moving out because he was in that little complex. He bought three homes somewhere. And he came out and he had an envelope. He said, thank you guys for saving my life. And he left. And of course, the two, the assistant and Monk, were going, you know, whoa, what's it worth? What's a life worth? He was like, $200. That's kind of the way it is when we give so little. I don't mean time, money, whatever. When you give so little, it's like, wow. He became poor. He took the brunt of torture. He was tortured. God was tortured for you and me. What does that mean? How much is that worth? And I know we're dealing a lot with this incomprehensibility. It's just too hard. It's easy to talk about. But it's incomprehensible that God suffers, that God loves me, that I'm saved by grace. Those are hard concepts. I understand that. But look at what he's done. It's anchored there. What Christ has done for us should be the impetus of all stewardship of time, talent, and treasure. What he did for us. It's our love for God. And by the way, the closer we get to God, the more we come to understand and comprehend his grace and his love and his movement in your life, the more you're going to want to give, the more generous you want to give. Now, I've got some numbers, and I just put some scripture readings from 2 Corinthians by them. I want to look at a couple of them. He's talking to the Corinthians, saying the Macedonian churches, this is just incredible. Out of the most severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. They gave as much as they could and as much as they were able, and even beyond their ability. What does that mean, giving beyond your ability? You got $5 and give six? Beyond their ability. This is also a poor place. These Christians are poor. Entirely on their own. They didn't have a stewardship sermon. Wow. That's incredible. Entirely on their own, they urgently pleaded with us for the joy of the privilege of sharing in this service. They pleaded. Please let us give. Did you see the Old Testament passage of Bezalel? Bezalel, remember that? Did you see? He said, God, to build the temple, God set aside gifted people who could do the curtains, you know, a lot of weaving, a lot of things like that. But he set aside those people, those who are gifted, but those who were willing. Out of that group that was gifted, which ones were willing to do this, to take on something that would glorify God? And then you got this church in Macedonia. Kind of sounds like he's trying to start a competition, you know, like we got guys on our team. You know, the Macedonian church is doing pretty well. How can you go above this? Giving beyond their means, pleading for the privilege of giving. Do we think like that? It's easy not to. I understand that. We have to fight against the culture who's thinking differently. But you realize the joy of giving versus just taking things and having things doesn't mean you can't have things. It's just saying, how much difference you want to make in the world? You can't have both. You can't have everything you want and have a world that's impacted for good. And that's what you got to figure out. You get to figure it out. The second quote, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7, each man and woman should give what he's decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. It's not under compulsion. But I think if you are a believer, you understand the theme here, what I'm talking about. You are free to give. But if we don't give, it usually is a sign of lack of maturity. As you mature in faith, you can't help but finally getting into a maturity of giving and sharing. Okay? Just automatically go there. Each should give what he's decided in his heart. You get to work with God on all that stuff. But again, the more we come into Christ, the more you're going to want to give. Time, talent, treasure. The more you're going to want to give. But we want the Holy Spirit to work that, not guilt. And then kind of an appendage there, 2b, Paul said, I'm not commanding you. There's no command here. This isn't have to and, you know, I don't want to. He's expressing freedom in Christ. And by the way, I was just reading Chuck Colson this morning or last night. You know, after a certain point, accumulating stuff doesn't give meaning and purpose to life. People want meaning and purpose. We're geared for it. It's in our, what do you say? It's hardwired in us. It's hardwired in us. We can't change that. So it's not reluctancy or compulsion, but we're just trying to give you, some of you are maybe just starting the journey of learning how to give what you want. Do you really want to watch 40 hours of TV a week? I mean, I do, but I'm saying, are we gonna? I love TV. I love it. Andy Griffith, the girls, our grandkids are loving Andy Griffith, so I'm really happy about that, my favorite show. But you understand there's competing things, isn't there? And part of it is pleasure and comfort. And those are tough ones. Those are tough obstacles. But this is you. There's no, we can't tell you what to do, but we can tell you what's best to be healthy as a Christian, to make a difference in the world. You're going to have to give. And you're going to want to give more and more as you do it. It is the greatest thing there is, besides loved ones. And a dog for Kay, maybe. What's the name of our dog, or your dog again? No, I pet the dog occasionally. Okay, three. Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Kind of sounds individualistic, a little bit, right? It's kind of, this is the selfish part. Hey, by the way, give. People need, the world needs you, and Jesus died for you. But if that's not enough, you'll be blessed. So he throws that in. But at this point, in my thinking, it's kind of cheap, a little cheap. When it comes down to you give because you love God, because you love others and you see them hurting and in need, what? Then we get something out of it. But by the way, he also talks about you're going to be enriched so that you can enrich more. So when things come into your life, they're not supposed to stick. They're supposed to keep going out, keep going out. But you understand, when you get to this point, I don't really care much. It's my love for God and my love for the world and others, and I'm hoping that increases. That's what I'm concerned about. Who cares? You already got it. It's more blessed to give than to receive, right? On the other hand, Kay and I have given a lot away. But guess what? We've been given to a lot. A lot. We've been on the receiving end a lot. I've had to learn that one. That's a harder one. It's more blessed to give than to receive, but it's harder to receive than give. But that's another issue that we need to work out on our own. So he who sows sparingly reaps sparingly. When we started Bible Live Ministries, I'm not a businessman, but we started a ministry, and that has a lot of my books that I write, a magazine that we started, and so forth. It was a risk, but we felt God calling us to do it. And we were $30,000 in debt by the time we realized that we didn't have enough churches to make it. That's kind of nice to find out after you launch your magazine. But then the break happened, and churches came out. We were just on the edge of bankruptcy. We owed $30,000, and we'd have to swallow that, because of the magazine. And then the break happened, and all these churches came out. And then Solo Publishing called me one day and said, "Can we buy your magazine?" I said, "Yeah, $30,000. $30,000. And it's still going. God wants us to take risks. I mean, in your own world, the widow's, her little mite, her penny, was a risk. We're not talking about how much here, but whatever it is in your life, it's taking risks sometimes because people are worth it, because the kingdom of God is worth it. And that, you know what? There's nothing better than being a companion, but a partner with God in giving in the world. Isn't it great? And that's what we're looking for in this church. We do want money, and if we don't get it, then we won't do it. But let's do it. Let's embark on something great. Let's start an odyssey here, a journey of seeing what we can do in this world more. How can we impact this world more? That sounds good, doesn't it? It sounds really good. Four, the service that you perform is not only supplying the needs of God's people, but is also overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God. Our giving is a way to show thanks to God for all he's done, especially what he's done in Christ. Giving is so cool. When I talk about it, I light up. I light up. So why do I hate stewardship sermons? Because as a group, it's hard. And I keep slipping back into selfishness and so forth. And we are forgiven. If for a while we just consume everything for ourselves, that's okay. Just get back on track. Now, some of the words that are used in 2 Corinthians are these. Willingness in giving. Eagerness, enthusiasm about giving, joy in giving, desire to give, not reluctant or under compulsion. And it shows thanksgiving to God. This was not a command of Paul. This was grassroots. It just sprung up within. That's what we're looking for. We're looking for people who God is working in their heart to become more committed to being a partner with God and serving God in the world through your money and your time and your talents, together and individually. The early church, remember what the early church did? They didn't think 10%. They weren't thinking 10%. They shared everything. They pulled their money and they shared it. Remember Sapphira and Ananias? Remember they held back a little bit? They weren't killed because they lied. They lied. But it was their money. Remember that? It was like, while you had the money, it was yours. This isn't against ownership of or having possessions or ownership or whatever. This has to do with whether they're committed to God or not. Okay, let's start the run towards the end here. You maybe heard a sermon there out there about in tombstone. On a tombstone, you have, what do you have? Your name, and then it has the dates, right? Kent Grothy 3661 dash whatever. Hopefully that's going to be a while. But it's got the dash in there. You maybe heard people talk about this. That dash, that's what counts. The years look bigger, and they take up more space, but it's that little dash that matters, isn't it? What is going to happen in the dash of your life? When you get done, is it mostly going to been about yourself? Or is it about caring for people in need or advancing the kingdom of God together and individually? What are you going to do with your dash? What are you going to do with your dash? Let's recommit to making a greater difference in the world. And we're going to do it together, too, as a church. We're going to go farther. We're going to do more. We're going to make a greater difference in the world because it is the greatest thing we could do. Amen.